Sometimes I think I'm bad luck for a restaurant, or at least for a particular menu item. Over the years, a great many of my favorite dishes have been eliminated. Crab mozzarella at Miller's Ale House, the Lake Mineola pulled pork monster burger at Lily's on the Lake, the Choco Taco at Taco Bell. They were all delicious. I love them all, and now they're all gone. I've been luckier with bass lures. Sure, there have been a few favorites that were eliminated, but very few. And I've generally replaced them with something so similar, I doubt it matters to the bass. Lures go out of production for one very simple reason. They don't sell. It actually has very little to do with catching fish. If a lure is so unattractive that it doesn't sell, no one ever finds out if bass like it or not. But if it looks good to anglers, and flies off the shelf, the manufacturer will keep making it forever. The old saying goes, before a lure can catch a fish, it has to catch a fisherman. Eventually, though, a lure does need to catch some fish to stay popular. But occasionally, a bait will fail in the marketplace despite having a cult following. The company will stop making it, and it will come back into production only after it wins a big tournament or gets some other notoriety. That's what happened to the Rebel Pop-R. I'll bet you own a couple of them. I certainly do. Rebel started making the Pop-R in 1976, but poor sales caused them to drop it from the catalog in 1978. It stayed out of production for nearly a decade. All the while, though, there was a group of Texas pros who were buying up every Pop-R they could find. And when they couldn't find any, they'd special order them in quantities that would make an independent retailer choke. Those pros included Rick Klun, Bobby Murray, Tommy Martin, and Zell Roland. They managed to keep the Pop-R a relative secret until June of 1986, when Roland won the Bassmaster Super Invitational on Chickamauga Lake in Tennessee. Rather than hide the winning bait from the media, Roland shared it, simultaneously building his legend as the greatest topwater angler in bass fishing and irritating the other pros who were in on the secret. As you might imagine, demand for the Pop-R grew, and Pradco put it back into production. Some variation of the lure has been made by the company ever since. Today, Rebel has at least 7 versions. But the production cycle of the Pop-R was an outlier, an example of something that rarely happens in the marketplace. It was a product that did not sell initially despite being very effective. It needed the boost of a national tournament spotlight for anglers to give it a chance. And that story is a great example of one of the things that holds fishing back as an industry and which frustrates tackle manufacturers to no end. When we as anglers find something that works, we feel incentivized not to share it. We want to keep it to ourselves so we can be successful while other anglers, often including our friends, struggle. In what other industry does that make sense? If you had a great boat, you'd tell your friends. If you heard a great song, you'd play it for them. If you ate at a great restaurant, you'd spread the word and recommend your favorite dish. You might even be able to save crab mozzarella, the Choco Taco, or even my beloved Lake Mineola pulled pork monster burger. Look at that thing and weep with me, knowing that it's gone, despite the fact that I told others about it. But sharing special lures is not what most bass anglers do. We hesitate to share our favorite fishing waters or our most successful baits. We might talk about a rod or reel or line or a new knot, but lures are different. We think of them like they're magic, secret sauce. Truth is, we should share that information. If only to help a company sell more quality baits, and to keep those baits around so we don't run out. After all, when our favorites go out of production because they don't sell, the first person to blame is usually staring back at us in the mirror. Welcome to Bass After Dark. For the next 90 minutes or so, we hope to show you that inch for inch and pound for pound, we are the most illuminating show in all of bass fishing. Now it's time to bring on my co-host. He underwent reconstructive shoulder surgery this morning, because he's carrying the weight of this show on his back. Please welcome Brian the Carpenter.
Outstanding, Ken.
BTC, how are you feeling? Just this morning, you made your surgery.
Pretty good, man. No pain. But that's because they got me on a nerve block. So I also have a dead arm. It's just when that wears off, I'm going to give you a call.
Well, I was worried you weren't going to be able to be on the show tonight. You know, that's something we've been discussing for weeks, ever since we knew your surgery date. Thrilled that you're on the show with us.
Yeah, I'm a little bit better conditioned than I thought I'd be.
Yeah.
In regards to your intro, you said something kind of triggered a memory. We had an old timer that used to work for us. My brother's 12 years older than me, and I grew up working for him in construction. And so when I was in my 20s, he had somebody that would have been like our dad's age, which is equal to dead at this point.
Yeah.
He's dead years old, but the old geezer, we called him. And Mark had a saying, if you got a friend that's good and true, better screw him before he screws you.
Wow.
But in regards to tell your friends, use this bait, go out on the lake while you're working and catch them all with it. You know?
That's harsh. But I get it. I get it. I mean, I've been in that position before where I've found a bait that really is working well for me and I'm excited about it. And I usually tell a few guys, but very, very few. And that's kind of antithetical to what it takes quite often to keep these baits in production.
Yeah. It's a fine line, man. You got to balance it, you know?
Absolutely. And, you know, I want to throw this out there to anybody who might be listening to tonight's show on Spotify or Apple Podcasts or any other platform out there. This is going to be a pretty visual show. We'll do our best to describe some of these baits as they pop up. But if you have a chance to watch us on YouTube or another platform that's got the camera and so forth, that's probably the best way to handle this one.
Right. You want companies to sell enough baits to stay, to keep making them, but not so many that the fish stop biting them.
You know, I really don't mind if a lot of people are catching fish and they don't fish anywhere near me. Then they can know about the bait. That's cool.
I agree. Unless you believe in morphic resonance.
I don't even know how to spell that.
Yeah, we'll get into that in another show.
Excellent. Excellent. Is that going to be part of the big reset?
Might be.
We'll schedule that one. We got a great show. Really excited about our question. We got our top 10 coming up a little later in the program toward the end. And a new segment we're going to introduce too. So,
maybe two.
Yeah, we got lots of stuff. Bass After Dark does not rest. And BDC, can you remind everybody about our question, our topic tonight?
Yeah, sure. Ken, that is an excellent question, Ken. Let me remind everybody what that.
I've got that. If you don't,
something about resurrection and the third day. Roll away the stone, and which bait would you like to see resurrected?
Yes. Which bait do you want to see brought back from the dead? That's been discontinued by its manufacturer.
And another way to say it.
A terrific panel. And let's get our panelists out here because, we don't have a show without them. And B, these are just the guys that everybody's going to want to hear from on this.
Indeed they are. And here we go. Our first guest tonight, our first expert panelist tonight. He is, what the deuce?
You need me to do this? You got your stuff there?
No, got it. It's just somebody scrambled everything.
Uh-oh.
And begin. Our first man tonight. Sorry, Ken. He is an NPF.
No.
He's a Bass Pro Tour angler.
Yes.
Two-time One Bass U.S. Open champion.
Yes.
Seven-time Bassmaster Classic qualifier, three-time BASS winner, 2008 Bassmaster Open champion on the Toledo Bend, 04 winner, 07 Elite Series win, this, that, and the third. One of, if not the nicest man in all of the world.
No question.
Yes. John Murray.
John, welcome.
Hey guys, how are you?
Doing good, man. Thank you so much for joining us on the show. We really appreciate you.
Always, I've always wanted to be on, so I'm here. I'm enjoying Excellent. It.
That's fantastic. You're the best, and we're going to get into some of John's picks for baits to be resurrected. But BTC, we got a couple more guests.
All right, let's keep this amazing smooth content going. Former Bassmaster Elite Series angler, two-time classic qualifier, winner of the 04 Bassmaster Northern Open on Lake Erie, Matt Pangrack's sidekick, as Ken says, another word for it. And the day four, the man who invented day four, used to be Mr. Frankie Scalish somewhere along the line when they came over. It's now Frank Scalish.
Frank.
John, it's been a long time, bud.
Absolutely. I haven't seen you.
There, you guys have known each other for a long time. You guys fished the Elite Series together for a while when Frank was on the Elites. And Frank, we know you were busy this morning with Bass Talk Live. Thanks so much for making your day longer and joining us on Bass After Dark.
No problem. Glad to be here.
All right, BTC, we got one more.
That's right. Frank, was I correct in that enunciation?
It's Scalish now. It used to be Scalisi.
Ah,
how about that? I was close.
You were damn close.
Damn right I was. All right. Last man in. 19 years with TW Tackle Warehouse, including 16 years as a buyer. Got serious as bass fishing when he was just 13 years old. Longtime friend of fishing buddy of
Rich Zelenga.
Oh, okay.
Owner of Tackle Warehouse. And a great friend of
Jared,
I think just about everybody on the show here, Jared Lintner. Yeah,
right, and a punk rock tour fanatic, I believe. Which we're going to go deep into, Ken, because I know you'll. Oh, no, I'm kidding. We got the Hodgie, Jeff Hodges.
Hello.
Jeff. Hey. How's it going,
Jeff? You are wickedly backlit. Any way we can get a light on your face there?
Yeah.
Maybe. You know, unless you're in hiding from the federal authorities.
No, I'm in my little tackle room and it's super old and crappy. I'll try to find another light real quick. So,
and but yeah,
if you can, that'd be great. But right, cool. But anyway, we're excited to have you. Thanks so much for joining us. Your experience and relationship with manufacturers and so forth plays very big on this topic. And you know, one of the things I want to get into, and I'll start with you, John. Are you a guy who carries a lot of out of production baits when you're in competition, or pretty much just the modern readily available stuff?
Yeah, I definitely own them all. I have them in my house, but I do not carry them necessarily on the boat very often. I mean, very rarely. There's a couple exceptions that, you know, some of those old standards that might be in my box once in a while, but overall I'm trying to stay, you know, relatively, recent on my baits. And, I look at them and I think about bringing them, but I just don't do it as much as I probably should.
There you go. Yay.
I had a conversation one time with a guy who I know uses a lot of old baits. And that's, Jason Christie. Christie throws a lot of old baits. And one time I asked him why, and he had a really good answer. He said, I know exactly what they do. Rather than, you know, trying out all the new stuff, which he probably does anyway, he knows what a lot of these old baits do. Frank, are you an old bait guy? Do you like the stuff that's out of production because you know there are not a lot of other people throwing it?
Yeah, I actually do. And the problem that I have is probably OCD. When I have something I like, I buy all I can possibly afford. Some of the baits that we'll talk about today, unfortunately, I'm down to like a scarcity. So that bothers me. You know,
well, this won't help because our millions of viewers will be on eBay even while the show is in progress.
Come on, Ken, it's going to hold back.
Yeah, no, I scoured eBay. Trust me.
I do that regularly for a handful of baits. And like you say, some of the ones I'm looking for are not inexpensive. So that's problematic. Now, Jeff, you've got a relationship like few other human beings with manufacturers out there. Do you get pressure from tackle warehouse buyers who find out that one of their favorites has gone out of production and they want you to kind of leap into the breach for them and find a way to get more baits?
I've never really personally had that, like, from customers. I mean, the one guy in the office, though, Kata, who does a lot of our What's News, is always on me about certain, like, old Lucky Craft colors and stuff like that I don't know, Lucky Craft's a pain in the ass, and you can't get a lot of their stuff. So once the color's been ran through with that company, it's kind of like, get on eBay, like Frank said. It's probably your best bet to find it. But as far as customers calling and ragging about stuff, not really that I've heard of, you know.
It's interesting. BTC, yeah, man. Go.
I just want to say before you dive in, I wanted to follow up on something. Frank, Kenneth asked you about, you know, when you find a bait, like, do any of you guys, do you ever suffer from that thing where, like, you know, you get on a bite with a bait, you know, some particular summer, like, this is the bait, the color, you go all in and buy the hell out of it, and then never catch another fish on it the next year? Does that happen?
Yeah, it happens. I mean, truthfully, what I found traveling across the country is some lakes, the bass have a certain affliction for a certain color, hue, or color. And so you buy a ton of them, and then when you get back to your local waters, they just don't produce like they do on that one particular lake. I experienced that on Clear Lake and Smith Mountain Lake in Alabama.
Yeah, half my garage is like stuff that I caught the hell out of them one year and then never again.
John, do you find that you know, we talked a little bit about colors, and Frank was mentioning colors being hot in certain places. Do you find that it's more often that colors go out of production than actual whole lineups of baits?
Yeah, colors are a big thing. And just like Frank said, you know, you go to a lake like Shasta or Clear Lake in California and you have your color selection. And then, you know, you go to a lake in Florida and it's a totally different one. So that's the biggest thing I've always found about this is there's the colors disappear. Even the hues of colors, you know, a certain watermelon color, you know, 10 years later, it's gone. You can't get that hue. And as a bass fisherman, man, that sort of freaks you out when you don't have that one that you're used to catching them with, and you have to use one that's a little different. Man, it takes a little bit to get that confidence back.
One thing I notice about modern baits, I think the biggest difference, at least to me, and you guys are the experts, I'm not, but to me, the biggest difference between modern baits and older baits that were legendary in their era, are modern baits are typically more aerodynamic. They cast better. They've got maybe a weight transfer system or something like that. And I don't often find that maybe I think the old bait had more action, but the modern bait just throws easier and is easier to handle. Is that, am I wildly off on that? I think that's the biggest advancement in modern baits over the last 25 years.
No, I don't think you're wrong in that at all. I mean, what I'm seeing in the bait designing world is color is becoming way more critical than it was. If you look at the colors of yesteryear, they're very simple colors, you know, two colors, three colors, a blend, a bleed, some form of chartreuse, some form of orange. And today, with the advent of what's going on in the painting world, you have transparent pearls. You've got just this plethora of things available to you to create a bait that no one's ever seen the light of day before. The casting systems are great, But there are certain actions in old baits, and Ken, you're 100% right. There are certain actions in old baits, and a lot of it has to do with how they were made and what they were made of, that just produce. I mean, there's examples of that, like the original wiggle wart, the original deep we are, you know, that kind of thing. So if they change the components of it, they change the action or the sound of the bait. And that's why some of the old baits are really important, because they had something to them that had fish sex appeal. And so that's why when you get one that works, you lean on it.
I love that discussion, Frank, because I always wonder what makes these baits special. You mentioned a couple of classic ones there in the Storm era wiggle warts, back when the Storm Brothers owned Storm and make the wiggle wart, and all the speculation about what it was. Was it the plastic? Was it the fact that the two sides of the bait were slightly off center? Was it, you know, something else entirely? Love that stuff. Jeff,
yeah,
you have amazing data at your fingertips to talk about what anglers want. Do you see, and in a moment I'm going to get into the picks you guys have for the baits you want to see resurrected, but how quickly does the market move when it comes to baits and colors? How quickly do you see transitions?
Pretty fast. A lot of companies have way better abilities nowadays to turn something around if it's hot, you know, or whatever. Or they'll get their guys fishing it to kind of, and the guys they know are going to do real well with stuff, fishing certain colors and get them out in people's faces, you know, and tease them or whatever. And then they've already got, you know, the product built, you know, or whatever. So that's always good. It's way different nowadays than obviously how it used to be, you know. But yeah, I'd say the turnaround time just with production and everything else is a lot, well, obviously way better than it ever was. And if I know Frank and the Pradco guys do a lot of in-house special colors and stuff like that, I don't know how long it takes you guys to turn that stuff around, but I wouldn't imagine it takes that long to turn it around anymore, you know, with the factory painting and everything. So generally, if we order something, you know, you get a heads up from the vendor or whatever if it's coming, and you get it pretty quick and whatever. And you know what's coming, and you order it. And like I said, they get guys fishing it and whatever. If it's a hot color in a region, a lot of times you have to hunt it down if you don't already have it. But, you know, chances are if it's made, we try to have it at tackle. So
you don't miss much on that. And that was great. But Frank, just this morning on Bass Talk Live, you introduced a new Robin's Egg Blue, I think, in some of the right. Bandit crankbaits, I think it was. And of course, that kind of push on Bass Talk Live can make a big difference.
Can only be surpassed by that kind of push on Bass After Dark.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh gosh.
Do you want to go with Smoking Jacket Purple?
I may have to. Smoking Jacket Purple and matte black, or that's satin black.
Well, yeah, this is nothing but the finest here, man. I realize I probably can't be, you know, the best host or interviewer, but I can be the best dressed.
Yeah.
And that's perfect. What I'm going for. All right, guys, let's get into it here, because the crux of our question was, what are the baits that you guys want to see brought back from the dead? And John, let's lead off with you. I asked each of you guys to select a few, but John, if you had to pick your number one bait that you'd like to see back on the market, what would it be?
Well, the one I first talked about was the original Bobby Garland Gets It. And that's really what started everything.
The tube.
It's called a tube now. But, yeah. You know, when I grew up, it was called a Gitzit, and that's what it was. And it's a 3.5-inch long plastic lure, variety of simple colors, smoke sparkles, clear sparkles. But what it really was the original. I mean, right now, it's a Ned rig. I mean, if you put a tube on a 16th-ounce jig head like Bobby Garland used to fish it, it's a Ned rig. It's the same thing. Has a little more action than a Ned rig, but basically it's the same thing. and also look at the current phase of the hover fishing, you know, the lures that you're throwing at forward facing, you know, throwing on my Garmin LiveScope. This is the perfect imitator. I mean, you don't need all these fancy ones. So it's sort of funny, this tube that was invented in the 70s in Arizona for Roosevelt Lake or Lake Mead or Lake Mojave, it's all around lure. It still produces, and just different forms have come about of it. Obviously, there's still tubes made all over. There's smallmouth tubes with all the salt in them. There's flipping tubes with big thick walls. But the original Bobby Garland Gets It was actually the forerunner of all this, and it caught fish everywhere, every state, every kind of species, and it still does.
Now, what was special about this particular? I'll use it again too. On the Gets It, the original Gets It. Was there something special about that?
The way it was rigged with the 16th ounce head, when you threw it out on light line, Bobby, you know, I learned from Bobby Garland himself on Lake Mead, Lake Mojave, you threw that 16th ounce and it spiraled down. It did not go down like a Texas rig worm or something. It spiraled, it swam down to the bottom. Yeah. And it was the original sight fishing lure. You know, Guido was turned on to that. Guido Hibden was turned on to that at the U.S. Open by Bobby Garland. And he proceeded to make the G2 and all the tubes after that. But the original Bobby Garland with the thin plastic and the simple colors, it was a fish catching machine, and it still is.
Now, the way Garland was fishing it, at least initially, was he had that little jig head, like you said, a 16th. The head was external. Yep. He was just threading it on, much like you might if you were threading on the head of a plastic worm, conventional plastic worm. And that was his way. And back then, he was he was Bass and Man lures, and the king of, well, you guys out west had so many monsters of finesse from the Don Iovinos to Dick Trask, to Bobby Garland, Gary Garland. That must have been an amazing environment for you to come up in.
Well, Bobby was the first. I mean, there's no doubt Bobby was the first. He was the inventor of it all. And his ideas of, what a bass lure should be, I mean, it sort of formed what became after that. But yeah, he was the original sight fisherman. Before Guido... Guido made sight fishing popular in tournaments. Bobby Garland was catching him on sight fishing way before. He showed Guido all that stuff. So yeah, it's amazing to see what, the stuff Bobby invented and the lures he invented, and they've stood this test of time. So that's one that, that is one that will be in my boat a lot. And I don't have a lot of the original ones with original. I went to his factory. I picked out hundreds of them. And I'm like Frank, I'm down to certain colors on some of them. And I don't like throwing them anymore because I can't get that exact bait anymore.
Right. But, what's funny about that is the Bobby Garland Gets It, the number one color on Lake Erie was 200 green. And it was an off colored watermelon. It was the number one smallmouth tube on the lake.
When I was first seeing the tube, it was mid to late 80s, fishing with Mike, Ike, and the first thing I did was laugh at him for showing me that this is going to be, this is what's up this year. I'm like, dude, it looks like a squid. It's stupid. But we were threading the jig head inside. Slide it inside the bait and popping the line tie through and then tying it on. Did that later become the rigging?
That was definitely a later process. People made insider heads for it.
Right.
And it made it even more spirally.
Yes.
It really affected the action when you started putting the jig head inside. But yeah, the original, if you took the original two Gets It, and you put it side by side a little Ned rig today, you wouldn't see much difference other than the, one's hollow and has a little more action. But yeah, people talk about the Ned rig, and I've fished with Ned. I know how effective it is, but I also fished with Bobby Garland, and I saw how effective the original Gets It was.
There's a hero of finesse fishing, Ned Cady, longtime librarian at Kansas University, and really on the ground floor of a lot of that Kansas, Missouri finesse stuff that was going on in the 50s and 60s. Remarkable writer, one of my favorite people in the sport, and just an amazing historian. All right, Frank, you're up. What is your first choice for a bait you want to bring back from the dead?
Okay, so this is going to be tricky because I have two, but I'm going to pick one.
We're going to let you get to all of them, but you got to lead off. So
all right, I'm leading it off with the suspending fat-free shad. This bait was absolutely unbelievable crankbait. I don't know how many bass I caught on it. I don't know how many big bass I caught on it. It was special. I mean, you could tell the difference in them if you're out trying to hunt for them. The suspending ones have orange or red eyes, and they have red writing on the side of them.
Ah.
And actually, it'll say suspending on it.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. We got a couple of them.
Now, when did they stop? Any idea when they stopped making that one?
No, I'm not 1,000% sure on that, but it was, I'll say quite a while ago, but when I say quite a while ago, we're not talking about a decade.
Right.
You know, the reason that I love the bait so much was because after the deflection, like if I roll it over a big boulder, after the deflection, I would kill it. And it would just hang wherever it, as high as it deflected, it would just hang there. And a lot of times the bass would just smash it on the paws. And so that was like, when that happened to me the first time, the bells started going off. So then I started slow rolling it, where I would take one that dives deeper than the bottom that I wanted to fish, and you could literally crawl it along the bottom, and it would just bounce and ricochet off the stuff on the bottom. But I could fish it way slower than one that would float back up. Right. I would have to speed it up. But the coolest thing about it, and probably the most overlooked thing about it, was the sound it made was different than the floater diver. And it would dive deeper. Because it was a suspending bait, I can get an extra foot and a half out of the thing. So it was really, once I learned all the attributes of it, it was one of my mainstay crankbaits.
Oh, we're going to be picking on Bruce Stanton and Pradco tonight, because I got one. I got one coming up later that I want. Bruce, are you listening? I want you to make that. I want you to make Frank's bait. I want you to get that bomber suspending fat-free shad back in production, and I got one for you at the end. But Jeff,
yeah,
you gave us quite a few picks. I love that.
Yeah.
But I'm going to ask you to pick your very favorite right now. If you could only get one back in production, what would it be?
It'd be the Rapala Aristorat. I've got a handful of them. Paper towels.
Oh, and we've got a picture. We've got a picture you gave us too. So we'll put that up as well.
This is just, I dropped a paper towel. Just to kind of show the different sizes though. I mean, they've had numerous sizes in the line.
Much more realistic bait fish as a profile from the side.
A lot of cool colors, a lot of, you know, I'm pretty sure this bait was originally designed to troll for walleye.
Say it ain't so.
Yeah. From what Mark Fisher said when I talked to him over at the guy who designed it. He said that was the downfall of the bait because it was more of a trolling bait. And, all of us guys, you know, where I grew up, where I live, we didn't really have a lot of tackle shops. We had Kmart, which sucked. And it was like, it was stocked by I forgot the name of the distribution company, but they had, you know, you'd go in there and you'd find this or that or whatever, and most of it was crap. But we'd found that crankbait back, you know, in the early 90s. And I think that we were probably onto the Norman DD22 around that time around here as well. But that crankbait, it had a problem with tumbling. when you, you know, want to make a long cast with it. And when we found these bigger Ristos, they just fired like a rocket. And the way they backed out of cover when you're cranking them down the tops of trees or brush lines or whatever, the fish smashed them around here. They were great, you know, just on riprap banks, you know, during the winter and in fall, winter. They're pretty much, that's the other thing I like about them is they had so many different sizes. So you could fish it all year. And the patterns they did on them back then, you know, they were, for the time, they were really realistic, just that print they did on them and everything. And I love a crank. I still throw it. Fisher actually sent me a box full of them a couple years ago. And then one of the kids in the office, Doug, one of our new buyers, he actually brought me a few for like a Christmas gift, which was cool that were his grandpa's. So.
Oh, very nice. Yeah. Mark Fisher retired just a few years ago from Rapala, but long time design. He had his hand in a lot of things going on at Rapala for decades. And I don't think any bait came out of that company for 20 years or more that Mark Fisher did not put his imprint on in some fashion.
Yeah.
You look at the magnificent pro staff they've had through the years, including guys like Ott Defoe, Mike Iaconelli, David Fritz, Jacob Wheeler, but Fisher always had his imprint on anything that came out of there, and so many impressive, especially diving baits, you know, especially crankbaits. They've been a powerhouse for a long, long time.
Oh yeah.
I love it. I love it. I got to admit, guys, you're a couple of crankbaits here in a row. I'm a Florida guy. If I throw anything with a lift that big, you know,
yeah,
I'm dredging the hydrilla at that point.
You call it an anchor?
I call it an anchor. Yeah, that's it. Because, you know, I'm using our fishing rod for a depth finder for the most part. Notice BTC, I did not mention a brand of fishing rod there because, you know, but anyway. All right. John, you only gave us a couple, but give us your next choice here.
The one I picked out is still made. It's more of a, I guess it's a peacock bass lure now. I've used them for peacock bass, but the wood chopper and wood chopper's a topwater lure that was, it really came in the early 80s. I think it came out of Missouri. But the original wood chopper had these really sharp metal blades that were popularized on the U.S. Open in 1982, 1983. And I mean, they were the magic lure for a couple of years. You would, go out on Lake Mead, you throw this thing in on a point in 25 feet of water on top and make a couple of big rips with that bait. And these fish would come out of 20 feet to eat this topwater lure. It was like the most secret lure we'd ever seen. And eventually I'd take those props off that, you know, sort of an ugly wooden bait. And I'd put them on I'd put them on Smithwick Rogues or the Devil's Horses. Devil's Horses and other custom baits. And man, it was just the prop was what I wanted. And that's what I've kept. I still have some. You can still get some. But like I said, we use it tremendously as a peacock lure. But the calling up of deep water, top water fish is what the beauty of that lure did, and still does. The first U.S. Open was won on a Czar Spook, but
we got John froze up there. But I know what he's talking about. That top water bite on a bait like that, whether it's a ripping style bait, prop bait like that, or a spook or a Sammy or something, when a largemouth or a spot especially, or a smallmouth rockets up out of 15 or 20 feet of water and hits that lure, that's special. I've had a chance to do that a lot with spotted bass on places like Lake Lanier. John, are you back with us?
I'm here.
I'm sorry, man. You froze up for us a second.
I saw
there.
That. I saw I froze up a little bit.
Sorry about that, but you were telling us about the... Now, so you guys were ripping it. You guys giving a big, hard pull.
Yeah, the key was that noise, that just the draw, and you could draw fish out of 20 feet with that lure, and it wasn't you didn't want the little blades that a Devil's Horse one has. You wanted those big chopper blades, and it would just pull those fish up, and it was a magical topwater lure for a lot of years.
That's fascinating to me because when I think of topwater fishing in Florida, where we do a lot of topwater fishing, I think of the lures that I have the most success on are the baits that can give me quite a bit of action in a fairly small space. you know, maybe in a hole in the pads or something like that. But out there where you've got a lot of open water, deep water, very clear water, you're perhaps having to draw them from a long way.
Yeah, a lot of fish, you know, that they would live on those grass lines anywhere from 10 to 15, 20 feet deep in crystal clear water. I mean, the water right out there is very clear. But that, you know, they just wouldn't make that move unless you drew that attention with that bait.
Very cool. All right, John, even though you didn't pick a third bait, I'm going to come back to you in a little bit. Okay. And I'm going to ask you to lean on, you're not a West Coast guy anymore. Mm-hmm. You're a Tennessee guy now.
Yeah.
So I'll be looking to you. Yes, I'll be looking for you an Eastern style bait next.
All right.
All right, Frank, you're up. What you got for number two?
Okay. I'm going through a transition here. So number two would be a suspending jerk bait. It is the original Excalibur XT3. It comes in at three. It weighs in at 3/8 of an ounce. It comes in at 3 1/8 inches long. It's a tiny little dude, but it'll dive down to about 4.5 feet. The bait literally. When I fish this bait, I pull it down to depth and then I'll shake my rod tip and it'll quiver in its place. It's got a really unique quivering action to it. And that's what I really liked about it. It's one of my absolute favorite cold water baits. I have a lot of favorite cold water baits, but this one does a lot of dirty work for me, especially when the bass are not deep in the winter time. I can fish them and catch a lot of fish on them. And the cool thing about this jerk bait is you could fish it extremely painfully slow, or you can rip it. It tracks true and it catches fish both ways. As the water begins to warm up, then I start fishing it more aggressively and constantly. But in the wintertime, it's a slow pull, a long pause, a slow pull, rod shake, long pause, that kind of thing. I literally have been begging for this bait since the day they discontinued it.
I know that bait was kind of colloquially called the Excalibur twitch bait.
Right.
Even though it had, you know, those letter sequences and number sequences that I can never remember. Do you think the fact that you're not really twitching it, you're pulling it.
Yeah.
Do you think that hurt pull. The sales of the bait, that it was known as the twitch bait, but you had a different style, a more successful, different style of fishing it?
I think the twitch bait, was kind of a misnomer. Because really it was a suspending jerkbait, just a small one. And so back in the day when they discontinued them, I started scouring them up as much as I could get. Then I would sand them all down and paint them, because most of what I found was gold chrome or black chrome. And so I'd have to get the chrome off of them to paint them. And so then I would paint my own colors that work in places where I'm at.
If you donate, full screen, bud. If you're there, thank you.
And so then I would paint them to match
the beautiful
bait fish around me. And I just have so much success with them. And I think with today, with the colors and stuff we could do today, I think this bait could be rejuvenated in a huge, fluffy way.
Mm-hmm. Am I mistaken in saying that bait looks a little bit like a Pointer 78?
No, you'd be exactly right on the money.
But you like the action of this bait better.
Yeah, this bait gets down a little bit deeper than the 78 does. I fish them both. But this bait will get down a little bit deeper. And I've just seen too many times where, because I would have both of them on each one on a different rod, and they would have a preference. And so as soon as I saw the preference, I would take the preference bait. More often than not, it was the XT3. And so that was the problem. If I had a bait that would catch them the same, then I wouldn't worry about it, because right, you could go to the Pointer 78. But I've seen too many times where it just outperformed it.
Gotcha.
Right on. Yeah, jerk baits do be specific like that, huh?
Yeah, they do. They are.
Haji, what do you got, man?
Berkeley, the original Berkeley power craws. I loved them. All I have to show is the old little 3-inch guy.
Oh, my God. does it still have the original smell, or did it?
It stinks. Yeah, it's cool.
The originals are the best.
Yeah, I mean it's nostalgia when you open the bag, so it's cool to revisit, 30 years ago and however long ago it was when we were throwing those things around. It was super versatile for us out here. Throwing on like a back of a 1/4 ounce or 3/8 ounce skinny bear jig, or a lot of old guys around here hand tied little finesse jigs and crap, and we'd throw them like that as a trailer, shake them on brass and glass. Same like power crawl was always in the back of a rattleback or a weapon jig, flipping, or just flipping it straight lead weight, pegged lead weight with whatever kind of hooks we had back then. They weren't very strong, but. And then brass and glass again. That was all kind of like the way we fished them. But there's so many. I think nowadays with all the craws on the market, you're not getting anything unique. Basically everybody that comes out with a craw, it's a flappy craw. And nobody has just a straight craw-shaped worm anymore, which I think would probably be good to come back in the lineup eventually. Because, you can only... The fish have seen every damn craw go by. I'm like this, kind of like, all right. They're going to bite it, but I think, I don't even know if I had to have the realism to it. It's just that thing, that little power craw on the regular 4-inch power craw before they went into that detailed one they did afterwards with the rejuvenated power bait scent that sucked.
The worst.
Yeah, it was bad, but those craws. That was awesome, and I tried to find some 4-inch, on eBay, and you can't even find those really anymore. You find like a 2-pack for like $9, and it's some crap color that you don't want.
So it's the smell you like.
I like the smell, and I really like the profile too. It's just simple, and it's not so intrusive. And the lakes are where I live. It's bad, when I was a kid, I was like, I hope they never get like San Diego lakes around here. And now it's like what I used to fear when I was a kid. With how cool bass fishing's become, and there's all these young dudes doing it now. It's crazy. You go into the lake. If you take a day off in the middle of the week and there's 15, 20 boats in the parking lot, you're like, geez,
Right.
It's crazy. So, it's great for business. It is what it is, but. Just subtleties, I think, make a big difference now, especially where we live. And if, everything that you buy, I see it all at work. It's all basically the same. It's derived from the chigger craw, and it's all the same thing. It's all some flappy, same shape craw bait.
Did you prefer the 3 or the 4? Was there?
I depend on the time of year. If it was, going later into the year, to say, late November through like early February, the 3-inch was always a good one, like for that pre-spawn period, and then like winter and pre-spawn, and as it started to warm up, you can move to the 4-inch and flip it by itself or on the back of a rattleback or whatever.
I think a lot of it was also that original power bait.
Yeah, all the scent for sure.
They would hold that thing, and if you didn't look quick, because one of mine that's on the list, and I'm gonna throw it out right now, Ken, was the 4-inch power bait finesse worm, the string on a slider. Yeah. That was like my go-to find a bite, bait. Yeah. And, you gotta set the hook on them, or it ends up in their gullet.
Yeah.
Now, BTC, we got your finesse worm up there now. The power bait finesse worm now.
That is not it.
That's not it. Okay, my bad.
No, I'm trying to find
these things.
Power finesse. And maybe it is. I can't see anymore. But it was
the package probably looked like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was like the old red or blue, and you blue and yellow or red and yellow. That looked like the new stuff, the new package.
Yeah. It's hard to find high res images of baits that are out of production, of course.
And they're John, all moldy and in the trash.
Yeah, there's that. And John, when I found that picture of the Gets It The only picture I could find was a really lousy picture of them still in the bag, and that's why it looked like crap. Mm-hmm. That was the best I could do. But anyway, it's how dare you, gentlemen, assault the fine engineers, chemists, and designers at Berkeley?
Yeah, exactly. But he's right. That original scent was something else. And you'd leave those in your boat compartment, and your boat would smell like that.
Yeah. Well, hey, note to John Prochnow, Mark Sexton, and the retired Keith Jones. You guys did some great stuff in the past, and Jeff wants you to go back to those days. Bring it back. He says bring it back. And you know what? He's in charge at Tackle Warehouse. So if you not do, really. You'll sell a lot.
Shameless plug.
Yeah, I'm just trying to make everybody money, Frank. That's all I'm trying to do.
I love it.
the power bait lizard and the 7-inch worm are dynamite.
Yeah.
Back in the day. Yeah. Blue
camo. Still fairly 7-inch a lot.
Yeah.
Oh, we lose John. There's John.
Yes. I'm back.
All right, John Murray, one of my favorite people to work with in my decades of covering bass tours and stuff like that. I warned you earlier, John. I said I was going to come back to you and get one more pick out of you. Did you come up with something?
I'll give you one for, the Florida guys.
That's all I'm looking for.
Although, to me, obviously the root is in the West. There was a guy named Fred Kunkel out on the West Coast before all these guys that threw one bait, and he smoked all of us for years, and it was a floating Rapala minnow. And Bernie Schultz still throws it to this day in tournaments. The original ones that floated so high and just the twitch action. I mean, just the shake of the movement on the surface. Probably the most subtle topwater lure there is, but still one of the very best. Florida waters, Arizona waters, New York waters, California. It doesn't matter. That bait caught them top water everywhere.
Yeah, the original floating Rapala, hard to beat. I'm sorry, Frank, what you got?
I was going to say, how about the AC Shiner?
Remember?
Dude, that was same thing. High floating balsa bait, little quiver on top, same deal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great stuff there. And of course, that was what really put Rebel and Rebel on the map, was their Rebel minnow. Mm-hmm. That was their first bait, and they started an empire with that. Those floating minnows, especially back in the day, and Rapala had a massive advantage, because in the Life magazine article that published the story of Laurie Rapala and his original floating minnow, was the biggest selling edition of Life magazine in history, not because of Rapala, but because it was the issue that covered Marilyn Monroe's death.
Oh, man.
And she was on the cover. So it sold millions and millions of copies, and it made people aware of that bait, because after that magazine came out, it was kind of like the story of the Big O back in the early 70s. You know, you couldn't buy one, but you could rent one for like $50 a day.
You could rent one. Not where I live, dude. The Pike and the Muskies would take them all.
Well, yeah, that's right. Frank, we got to get you down here to America. Of course, here we got alligators, which are worse. Alligator clamps down on something you like, and you may not see it again.
You don't.
Well, Frank, I know you got another bait on your list of baits to be brought back from the dead.
Yeah, so I'm going to follow my transition here, and I'm going with a soft plastic.
Is there another word you can use, Frank?
Other than transition?
Yeah, it kind of has an awkward context in the 2020s.
I'm going to follow my progression.
I like it.
All
better.
Right.
Okay. Much better.
So I'm going to go with the Yum Bad Jamma. And this particular bait here was one of my absolute 100% go-to jig trailers. It looks like a twin tail grub, but it has little paddles on the bottom of the claws. So the action isn't as smooth and silky as a grub. but it's not as wild and crazy as some of the other baits today. Now, that here's what I liked about this. It has a flat body here. I got one right here. It has, it's a big bulky bait when you look at it this way, but it really has a slender body to it. So what that does is that doesn't get in the way of the gap of the hook. Because normally when you have a bulky bait, it's bulky all the way around and you close the gap in your hook, where this bait here doesn't close the gap in the jig hook. Nice. So it was, and because it's flat, if you're pumping a jig and you're hopping it around or dragging a football jig, which is my all-time favorite, it helps keep the hook point up instead of tumbling over back and forth because of the wideness and the body of it. So, and then it was discontinued. I don't understand. Well, Ken, you made the point, because it didn't sell.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so it was discontinued, and it's another bait that I'm just fighting for. I'm fighting for this.
Now, Frank, when you're fishing, obviously, if you're dragging the bottom with a jig or something like that, you're going to have those tails running perpendicular to the hook. If you're swimming a jig and it's a bluegill spawn time, would you turn that trailer sideways and run it parallel with the hook?
No, I leave it, when I'm swimming a jig, I leave it rigged the way it's the normal way I do it.
Gotcha.
It helps the jig float in the water.
Yeah. Better.
And so I'll leave it rigged like that. I've also fished it on a chatterbait, which is, it's psycho on a chatterbait, but, ooh, it's just versatile. It's simple. I think with what they can do with soft plastics today, color wise, I wish this bait would have stayed. I have probably 20 bags left. And I'm like, I barely throw it now because I'm freaking out. I don't want to lose them all.
Come on, Bruce Stanton will do whatever you say. I'm sure.
Oh yeah, you got the wrong impression of me over there. Yeah,
for folks watching and listening, Bruce is the head guy at Pradco Fishing. Wonderful guy.
Yeah.
And a strong reason that set of brands has done so well over the decades. And I'm only buttering him up because I'm going to ask him to bring a bait back into production later.
Perfect. I'll back you on it.
I appreciate that, man, because this one's going to be an uphill battle. An uphill battle. Actually, Nathan, after we get Jeff's next pick, I'll ask you to bring up my number two pick in a photo, because then Frank will know that we got basically no chance in hell with Bruce on this one. I'm still gonna make the push.
Dude, you have me so curious now. Oh. I'm like racking my head trying to figure out what it could be.
Well, when you see it, you'll know, and I think you'll be on my side, but especially where you live, I think you'll be on my side. Anyway, Jeff.
All right.
You're up, brother.
Pro Assassinator Clacker Spinnerbait.
That is a cool looking spinnerbait.
Yeah. It's a unique bend on the wire.
Full screen. Yeah.
Basically, wait, let me try to figure out how to do this. So two spinnerbait wires. When you fish it and it's coming through the water, the blades just sit close to each other. And when they drop in the retrieve, you change the speed a little bit, it kills the blades. This spinnerbait, it didn't live for very long. The company sold to Persuader, that was, you know, based out of Northern California, and then it died. But I was telling the guys in the office earlier today that spinnerbait, the bites I used to get on it, I just finally bought some on eBay like last winter. So, it is nuts. I mean, your spinnerbait bites in general can be pretty awesome, but when they bite this thing, it just, because it's when that stops, you know, it's just they're tracking it or whatever, and that the blades clack, the bait dies, and they hammer it, and it just, they'll drop slack in your line when they bite it. Sometimes it's pretty rad.
That's awesome.
It's a really cool spinnerbait. But the only thing is, you got to reel it really slow, or it will pull up on its side, it just does wacky crap. So I think that probably might have been one of the problems with it. When people threw it, they didn't, you know, they didn't experiment with the retrieve speeds. They threw it and what, you know, brought it back. Things pile, you know. So
but it had to be expensive to make too.
Oh yeah, I'd assume so. I mean, it's that unique wire bend and everything on there, you know, two ball bearing swivels. The blades were really nice. They used a good hook. So it wasn't like, you know, a lot of spinner baits coming out that were junk. You know? Yeah. So it was cool.
Yeah.
It looks pretty sweet.
Yeah. It's a really cool bait.
I've never seen one.
It's called the Bass Assassinator Pro Clacker Spinner Bait. Persuader had it too. And I think they just called it the Persuader Pro Clacker. But they're all, you can still get them. There's a bunch of them on eBay. They make a lot of, looks like they may have gotten popular in the redfish arena, because I believe they might be still, the company might still be in existence, but they're only making like reds and purples and gold blades and stuff like that for a redfish. But yeah, I at least saw those on eBay as well, and then came across that one that you see in the picture, and those ones are awesome. I wouldn't recommend, if you buy them, getting anything under a half ounce, just because of the problem with it rolling and wanting to come in on its side. Yeah. But you could lead shank the hook or whatever if you needed to get more weight out of it to move it a little bit faster, I guess. But yeah. It's pretty rad. I'd suggest trying to get some and throw it. It's cool.
Jeff, yeah, was that thing luck. Like, yeah, good. That's going to be hard to find, especially after the millions
on the people who see this. But 15 fat-free shads on eBay. So,
well, Jeff, that thing had to go for close to twice what a conventional spinnerbait would sell for, didn't it?
Yeah, I think at the time when we carried them, this was when we first started out in our little tiny like garage warehouse. I think we were selling them at $9.99 probably. So, you know, conventional spinnerbaits at that time were probably $4.99, $5.99. So you got double the price, and it's wacky as hell looking, you know. So to get somebody to buy it, you know, over a regular spinnerbait, you only have so many people that are actually willing to do that. You know, like, this already works. Why am I going to buy that? But another reason, I mean, living it like we've all keep saying out here, you kind of have to do some weird crap and throw some weird crap to get bites, because there's so much pressure all the time on the little tiny lakes we have. So
it's like an early, maybe not even an early Alabama rig, but it's almost like its own little mini Alabama rig on some level.
Yeah, all right. That's cool.
Nathan, if you don't mind, I'm going to ask you to bring up the picture of the bait that I want to bring back. And now that we've got Frank Scalish on here, and he basically can tell everybody at Pradco what to do.
That's so Frank, funny. I want you to get that. So many levels.
I want you to get that Arbogast team working and bring back the wooden musky jitterbug. There is nothing like this bait. It is the single greatest big bass catcher of all time.
Statistically speaking,
there are still four current largemouth bass records on the books caught by this bait, including one in Rhode Island in 2016. Ohio once had a state record caught on a musky jitterbug back in the day. But through the years, there have been well over a dozen states that produced a record on the musky jitterbug. And it needs to come back, and it needs to come back in wood, because straight out of the box, the sucker needs some different hooks. It needs some longer screws. It needs some modifications. My buddy Jimmy Zinker has modified the handful of musky jitterbugs that I have left. I have four. I left one conventional just so I'd have it, and he's modified the rest to be better, you know, some different hooks, some better hardware and so forth. But Frank,
Can I ask you a question?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Raise your hand.
Now, don't be mad at me.
Too late. Go ahead.
So, in your modification, or you don't want to go down this road?
No, God, it's not a secret. It's not secret stuff.
Are you taking the two side hooks off and putting one belly hook on and one tail hook on it?
Well, it has a tail hook already, but it's under slung. Right. It's under the abdomen. No, I'm leaving the side hooks on it, and we're leaving the tail hook. Although Jimmy does sometimes reposition the hook so it comes right out of the end of the bait. Gotcha. And he's a better jitterbug guy than I am. This guy catches dozens of big fish every year, fishing at night with a musky jitterbug wooden. And they haven't been made since the 80s, maybe since 1980. So it's been a long, long time that they've been out of production. He also changes the line tie because it's got that like
rivet.
Yeah, that rivet in there, which is not the strongest connection you could possibly want, because you're going to want to throw this thing on 65 or 80 pound braid. And in my part of the world, you're gonna deal with a certain number of alligators.
It's true.
Next on Swamp People, Ken. Yeah, exactly.
So, but I want this thing back, because if you go on eBay and you try to find one these days, they're 40, 50 bucks. And then you got to sand them down and paint them black, and you got to do all this stuff to get them right. So Bruce, Mr. Stanton, let's get that wooden musky jitterbug back. You know, I want it. Now, you know, Frank wants it desperately.
I have a play we might be able to make.
Well, let's hear it.
Maybe I can get him to do a limited run.
Yes, the Scalish Duke limited run of wooden musky jitterbugs.
Yeah, screw the hell up. The rest, fuck us, right? Yeah, Scalish Duke. Here we go. You hear that, Nathan?
What are you mumbling?
He's high on painkillers. And
his nerve blockers and nerve running blockers. Out. Yeah. It's running out.
John Murray, I thought that he told me they were nerve blockers. I'm worried they may be brain blockers. I'm just not sure.
I've been on them for years, dude.
I had shoulder surgery too, and
what'd you have?
They thought it was a shoulder problem, so they went in orthoscopically to fix it. When they got in there, they found out that my bicep tore and reattached in a funny place. So when I would move my arm a certain way, it would dislocate my shoulder. And so I'm just going to tell you right now, dude.
I had my bicep tendon reattached in 22, cut and reattached.
Okay, so when your nerve blocker wears off,
I know it's coming.
I'm afraid for you.
I mean, I've been.
We're live on Bass After Dark.
Oh yeah, that's pretty.
Yeah,
just nice. Keeps going too. I'm not sure how long it is.
Nice job.
Yeah, look at that.
Nicely played.
Anybody got a hernia surgery they want to show off?
I just got my hip replaced.
There you go. Jeff?
What?
Let's see. Welcome to Scars After Dark.
Yeah.
What are we doing?
I don't know.
We're going down a dangerous road.
John, save us. John Murray, save us.
You're out of bait.
Hey, I just found out I got a whole bunch of 100 bags of Berkeley Power Craws, and I'm going to put on eBay.
There you go. I'll buy some of them.
What else you got?
I love it.
I got a lot of old stuff. But yeah, I didn't know the Power Craws were in such demand.
They're really hard to find. I mean, like I said earlier, too, a lot of them, if you get some of them, they have that like white mold growing on them, and they're junk. Then they stay funky in their trash. So yeah.
I got some old ones that are pretty pristine.
Never been open.
Never been open, just sitting there.
Nice. Cool.
Okay, Jeff. Other than your hip replacement scar, do you have any other do you have anything else you want to show us that you'd like to bring back into production?
Yeah.
Circumcision
me off guard. probably reaction innovation boom boom tube.
Whoa, okay. Show us one of those. Got if those you would. Too.
They don't make those anymore. I don't think they ever will. But 5-inch flipping tube, oxblood, awesome. The only thing was they weren't solid through the head, so you had to like bite off a piece of a power worm or something and more
put it inside.
Shove it up through the tip of the deal so it wouldn't rip out. They didn't last very long. See, but you got a lot of big bites on them. They had obviously reaction for the time, had the best colors out there. And yeah, I'd love to see that bait come back. There's a lot of bigger tubes out there, but the walls are too thick. The pores are not right.
They don't move as much.
Yeah, they don't. They don't have the fluidity. They're just not good tubes. And
that what hook would you use, Jeff?
That one I was, usually like a 4-aught EWG at the time. Now I've kind of transitioned to more of a straight shank, and I do that little slit trick in the tube, and you hang up a lot, but you get a better hook set with like a 5, like that 4-aught or that 5-aught owner, that new owner flipping hook.
Frank, do you remember they used to have that shiner hook that they used to sell that had the little clip on it?
Custom made.
Yeah.
Grigsby Shaw.
Yeah, but exactly, I mean, they had a custom one too that was the guys who follow our tournament trail sell them, and that was all we used was the boom boom tube with that hook, and man, you never lost a fish on that.
Really?
Yeah, it was a weird. It's a weird style hook too.
It's
a real weird looking hook.
Wouldn't use anything other than a tube. A boom boom tube was perfect for it.
Yeah. Did you guys, was that the one that you could put like the weight on the end of the wire and then go through the tube and rig the weight on the inside Texas rig? You know what I'm talking about?
I never did, but I'm sure you could. Yeah, yeah. It was a custom wire that they put on.
Yeah.
And the problem was the wires eventually would break.
Yeah.
Right. So yeah, they wouldn't last super long, but it was a good system.
Was it, where would we find a picture of this?
It's a Shaw Grigsby's
HP something hook, HP tube hook or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Here, I can draw it real quick.
I'm going to Google it. Type and left-handed with thumb sucks.
I actually have one in my basement. It is so bizarre.
Go grab it.
But you wouldn't set the hook on it. You just sort of pull on them.
Huh.
And they'd hook every time. It was amazing how well they hooked. But with the big flipping tube was the primary bait for it that I used.
It was weird. It was a weird hook, and the wire was like tied on, and it came down and came up and it would hook around.
Oh yeah.
You'd basically Texas rig the tube, and then you'd that piece of the wire that Frank has drawn, you'd jam that back through the plastic of the tube and hook it around the shank.
Like a snaps or whatever. Like
yeah.
A snap.
Clip it in there.
Okay, cool.
It was pretty nifty.
Mm-hmm.
And it helped your tubes last longer. I didn't throw a lot of tubes because I hadn't given up on fishing at that point. I'm kidding.
I didn't quit yet.
that's a bad Florida guy joke. But here's a bait that none of you guys listed when we reached out to you to say, hey, let us pull some pictures together or send us some pictures. None of you guys mentioned this bait, and it really kind of surprised me. And that is and we've already talked about it a little bit, but the old Storm Wigglewort. That to me is the legendary bring it back bait.
Right. And I purposely didn't mention it because I thought everybody was.
That's a pose. Yeah,
that's the original pose.
Yeah. The toe plug would be good one.
We're looking really bad right there, Nate. Like really bad.
No.
Wigglewort's been brought back so many times in so many different forms. That's why I don't say it.
And you know, that brings up actually where I kind of wanted to go with this, because there's so much debate as to what it is that was special about the original. Some people say it was the type of plastic used. Some people say that the two halves of the molds were not perfectly aligned and that caused it to hunt. Some people say all kinds of different things about why that bait was different, special. Some people say that the molds went to another person after the Storm Brothers sold out to Rapala Normark. I don't know what the truth of any of that is, but I love that everybody has their conspiracy theory about it. And of course, the Rapala people will tell you that the Wigglewort is just the same as it always was, just as good as it always was, if not better. And of course, their pro staff, which is paid to say so, will tell you the same thing. I'll bet you that all three of you guys, and BTC, I'll bet four of you guys, and myself as well, have some original Storm Wigglewort. John, do you think the original is somehow different, better than other comparable baits or the modern wiggle wart?
I think the original ones had some pluses over the newer ones, but you know, some of the advances, the rock crawler by Mike McClellan. I mean, that thing casts a mile, dives deep. It does everything you want. Doesn't hunt quite as much as an original, original wiggle wart, but man, I got quite a few of the original ones. I don't throw them, one, because they're rare, but two, because I feel like there's better baits as far as efficiency in tournaments, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, going back to that casting distance thing and the better aerodynamics and so forth, that's, I think, a massive improvement over the baits of years ago. I'm sorry, Frank, I interrupted you.
No, I interrupted you, but thanks for letting me talk now. I actually throw the Norman middle end in place of the original wiggle wart. I have four original wiggle warts, and I noticed with comparing it to the original, there's a slight build design difference in the original from the new one. And it's slight, but the wiggle wart almost acts like a flatfish. Remember the old flatfish? It really
Heelin' flatfish. Yeah.
It really does a lot of that stuff. Where the new one behaves more like a more crankbaitish.
Never thrown a flatfish.
No, yeah. Nor have I.
They were in my first time. Because
I live in steelhead country.
Yeah, it's trouty things.
Jeff, what about you?
What's that? What about me?
I was gonna ask. Well, BTC was asking Frank about
middle end.
Oh. Yeah, the Norman bait.
Oh yeah, the middle end is a beast. It's an absolute beast. I grew up right? fishing. What's that?
It's just basically a square bill. It's like a fairly.
It's got the same bill as the wiggle wart.
About 3/8 ounce, a little short, like 3 inches altogether, probably. It's a smaller profile crank. It's cool.
It's just, I grew up fishing Normans. Normans were probably the first crankbaits that I really got into hard.
Yeah.
And, they're made out of butyrate. They're gel coat dipped, so they're heavy. They cast a mile. The middle end actually is different than the rest of the Normans. The rest of the Normans, like the deep little end, the DD22, they swim down to depth, where the middle end is really like almost like the original rock crawler type bait. And so that's, you know, that get a lot of work for me because A, they were readily available. You didn't have to monkey around with it too much, you know, so that's pretty much.
I got you. I might be thinking of.
You're thinking of the Fat Boy?
No, maybe it's like the shallow lip on the end.
Oh, the.
Because there was a bigger body that.
Yeah, the Norman. I can't believe I'm having an adult moment here.
Yeah. So I threw a baby end and deep baby end a lot around here. That was my deal. And we don't have a whole lot of 22 feet. It's usually about 3 feet.
Where are you? Are you in Florida too?
South Jersey.
Gotcha. Yeah.
What about that one you showed a minute ago, the Poe plug? I mean, that was one that has not really been duplicated to any great extent. And, you know, Fritz basically won everything there was on it for many years.
Yeah. That bait to me was hard to keep tuned.
Yes. Oh, 100% on it. If you tried to tune it.
Yeah. And talk about a guy who's been an amazing crankbait designer. David Fritz is
unbelievable.
Phenomenal.
Yeah.
First with Pose, then Rapala, then, you know, Berkeley. And now looking for somebody else. So if you're a major manufacturer
Fritz side now,
I'm sorry, what's that BTC?
I can't believe they're discontinuing the Fritz side.
I don't know what the situation is there, but it's shocking because that thing is done very, very well. I'm sure they're not discontinuing, but I think David is now looking for might be interested in finding a new home. I'm not exactly sure his situation there, but the pose baits not only won a lot of money for David Fritz, won quite a bit of money for Rick Klund too.
Mm-hmm.
Great stuff. Now, Jeff, I was going to ask you about the wiggle wart. Have you? I did a thing. I remember going to the Classic in like 2013, and it was on Grand Lake in Oklahoma, and I thought the conditions might be good for a wiggle wart bite. And I just went from boat to boat of the Classic competitors, and I said, sounds like an adult question, but it wasn't. I said, show me your wiggle warts. Mm. And every guy could reach in and pull out at least one 3,700 deep box full of original wiggle warts. What's your take on the original Storm proper era wiggle warts, Jeff, versus the newer stuff?
I honestly don't have a lot of knowledge or time. I've never even, I mean, I probably threw it when I was a kid. Now I don't have any of the old ones. I do have a 3,700 deep full of, I don't know, ones from 7, 8 years ago, 9 years ago.
And they're great baits.
Yeah, they may have changed between then and now. Who knows? I don't know. But yeah, I don't really have any experience with that original sought after, you know, late 70s, early 80s or whatever wiggle wart that everybody's paying 50, 60 bucks a pop for, depending on the color, you know? So
yeah, and over 100 if the color's right. Some of the craw colors go for over 100 bucks, I think, if they're
one
new.
One of the things I thought about the wiggle wart that I found out was the not clear lip, you know, the old gold lip, some of those solid colored lips, man, they destroyed people, you know, caught way more fish than a clear lipped crankbait did. And you just don't see that anymore.
John, offbeat question, not exactly on our topic tonight, but now that you've moved to Tennessee, you've been there for quite a while now. What is it about anglers from Tennessee that they just seem to be born with a crankbait in their hand?
Yeah, when I moved here, I have a back garage that I didn't really need much, but Ott Defoe said I had to start making crankbaits back there. Goodness. If I live in East Tennessee. So that's sort of the deal here. I mean, it's changing right now because of forward-facing sonar, but yeah, there's all these custom crankbaits around here, and they're beautiful, and they all have their use.
Yeah, that's a great point, the forward-facing stuff. East Tennessee, especially, just so rich in crankbaits. And, of course, the king of them all, the Big O. Nobody mentioned the Big O. And, of course, that's probably because nobody on the panel is really old enough. Well, not the Fred Young.
Not the original
Balsa.
One.
Balsa
one. I have one of those, too, downstairs.
Have you ever thrown it, Frank?
No, man, I won't throw that one. No way. There's too many toothy critters up here.
Right. That's a good point, yeah.
Toothy critter.
Toothy critters are not good for balsa baits or really any baits.
Or any bait.
Negative.
Yeah, that's not the best thing for that. But we're getting into championship season now. We got the Classic, the Red Crest, the NPFL Championship all coming up here. And, Jeff, this is mostly a question for you, I guess, but I'd love to hear also from John and Frank. Are you finding that a Classic win on a particular bait is having a diminishing impact on sales?
Yeah, we sell a pile of baits when somebody wins on it. I mean, that DT6 is still selling like crazy right now. So, it still makes a big deal.
Is it still as impactful? Well, you're not ancient like I am, so you can't go back and see what it does, 30 years ago or something like that. Whereas Frank and John are kind of my era. I just remember, sorry guys. I just remember when I was a kid, if something won the Bassmaster Classic, I don't care if it was a jigging spoon and I'm living in Florida, I got to have one.
Oh, yeah.
I still have Bagley Honey Bees that Rick Klund won in 1976.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. And that, yeah. And it's still that way. If a guy get, you know, you John, guys you gonna catch him.
I think it depends what the bait is.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
I think if it's a soft plastic, it doesn't have as much of an impact.
No,
I believe you're right. Amen. Yeah.
You know, I think if it's a unique hard bait, I think it does have an impact.
Yeah. Then when nowadays you have, I mean, with all the live coverage, you guys can't lie that much anymore. So you get a lot, you know, people, if they pay attention, they'll see what a guy's throwing, and that's when it bites you. Cause if somebody is sponsored by so-and-so company, but you look and they're throwing an OSP Blitz DR or something and they're saying, oh, I'm throwing this bait. And you're like, bullshit, you're not throwing that bait. And then you get cleared out on that. And then at the end, after people that may not be able to pick out the differences between baits when the guys are fishing come to, they do their interviews and they hold up their trophy and everything. And they're like, all right, I want it on this. And then, yeah, then you just see it go ape, you know, ape shit.
You made a great point about the live coverage. So here's what happens with that.
Yeah.
They'll use a handful of different baits and they'll catch a few fish on each of the baits. So they can't go up on stage and say, I caught them all on this. Mm-hmm. This is why I won the classic, because everybody sees that you threw this and you threw this and, you know, yeah, you caught fish on everything and yes, it helped you, but it wasn't the sole driving force of that victory.
Yeah.
And I think that's what matters.
Yeah, if you go back and you look at all the classics through history, you can count on one hand the number of events that were won on a single bait.
Oh, it's Hartwell. Yeah.
I'm sorry, what BC?
Hartwell?
Hartwell with Casey Ashley, that would be one of them, that underspin that his uncle was making.
Yeah.
And Rayo Breckenridge won on a jelly worm in 73, and small Okie Bug spinnerbait in 72, and Gussie Aggravator in 71, and Gussie perhaps. But yeah, mostly it's a variety of baits. Yeah. And I think that's, but you know.
The point was kind of, I think Hodge was saying, is integrity was kind of, may have been lost.
Point well taken.
The trust of the consumer, you know, kind of lost some of that. So it's a fine line. Yeah. You know?
It keep is.
Sponsors happy and also being as truthful and.
We're on it all the whole time that live stuff's on during the classic. We're all tuned in and paying attention. I mean, because if you're not and you're not trying to capitalize on what's going on at that time, you're missing it, you know. So we're very, you know, all the guys that I work with that buy at Tackle Fish, and obviously if we all pretty much know what everything is by now, you know, from all the product we carry. And you can, you know, we'll be like, hey, you see that? Yeah. And, you know, whatever buyer handles that product, it's like, get on it, dude, get that on order or whatever, you know, get it coming because it's going to go crazy in the next week. And if we don't have it, you know, it's not good. So
you guys all jump on Instagram and call everything a knockoff right after that?
No.
Prototype.
That's what Brian does. That's exactly what Brian the Carpenter does. Uh-huh. We did a show last week on, hot new baits for 2024. And as soon as one would pop up an image, you'd say knock off.
Yeah, that's too high. It's really hard, I think, for manufacturers to keep bringing unique product to the market. I mean, you can only do so much for so long. And it's kind of like, that's why you see, I think, why you see the color charts so large amongst all the different manufacturers now, because you can't keep bringing new cranks and this and that, that are going to like light the world on fire. But if you can bring an awesome bait that's proven and catches fish and give people some new colors to look at, they're going to keep buying it. So,
yeah, I think techniques drive baits.
Yeah.
Like forward facing sonar is so big right now. Everything you see new is going to be predicated on forward facing sonar. And I think that's a big thing. And the other thing, obviously, and Ken, you could attest to this totally, tournaments also drive certain lure sales. So as soon as like Fritz made his money because the tournaments were held in the times of years in the time of year when the deep crankbait was effective and was king. And when they started chasing the pre-spawn and the spawn around, obviously for, you know, viewer pleasure to see all the big giant fish being caught, it became soft plastics and that sort of thing. And now with forward facing sonar, it's the same thing. Every tournament, the guys are staring at their screen. And so now all your forward facing sonar baits, that's what brought jerk baits back to modern day time, was forward facing sonar, until the Damiki rig and guys started chucking them out, you know, for those fish. So
I think you're so right. And here's a question for all three of you guys. I tend to think of tournament fishing from 1975, when D. Thomas debuted flipping on the national scale at Bull Shoals, and he won that BASS event, until fairly recently, as kind of the flipping era.
Yeah.
Now, tournaments were won a variety of ways, but as soon as they kept dropping the creel limit and got down to 5 for most tournaments, it made flipping a player. Mm-hmm. And if you didn't have a flipping stick in your boat, you could not consistently be competitive and win. Is 2021, 2022 the end of the flipping era in modern tournaments?
Well, it's a whole nother show there, but you know.
That's right. Yeah, I'm sorry.
My bad. You, the three of you are forbidden from answering that question.
Okay.
Radio silence.
It was a perfectly good question. Okay, I got a question for John, though. All right, John. When was in the little monologue I delivered at the beginning of the show, I talked about how anglers kind of are incentivized to keep secrets. What was the last bait that you were trying to keep a secret for a while that finally got out?
Yeah.
It's been so long.
Really?
Because once we got the coverage we have now, there are no secrets, and you're incentivized not to have a secret. You want to get it out on the internet first. You want to be the guy that unveiled it. You want to be all that leading edge stuff. But yeah, there, you know, I made a living on secrets back in the 80s and 90s, you know, split shotting, then jerk baits, then top, you know, the Rico. I mean, there was baits that I would get a co-angler. I say, man, do not tell anybody about this thing. You can win so much money if you just use it yourself. And it's such a different world now. And I even taught fishing classes. But I had the topics that I taught, and then I had the few baits in my back pocket I never talked about. So yeah, it's a different, you know, sight fishing was forbidden to be talking about to anybody that didn't know what there was. And then they started doing seminars on it. I'm like, what's happening here? Why are they telling people how to catch these fish? This is horrible. So yeah, there's no secrets anymore.
Now, what did your sponsors say about that? Because that's obviously not going to make them happy.
Well, we didn't worry about sponsors back then. We, you know, we were winning money in tournaments. I never cared about sponsors. You know, that when I grew up, you know, it was gambling. I mean, you were fishing for money. That was it, you know, and I wouldn't.
That's so true. How many boats out west did you win, John? How many boats out west did you win, like, through the 70s and 80s?
Yeah, 31 boats and, you know, 7 trucks and, you know, that's what I fish for. But yeah, you had to travel around the country and take a technique. I took split shotting from California and I took it to New Mexico one year and won 3 boats in a row and never told anybody about it.
Yeah. Well, you're John Murray. I mean, yeah, you have that kind of legacy and you're one of the most influential anglers in the history of competitive fishing. Mm-hmm. At what point did the tide kind of turn where you said, okay, I've got to share to keep sponsors happy because that's where my bills are getting paid?
ESPN and Bass, you know, really the Elite Series, when the entry fees became so big and ESPN was all about the coverage, you had to have something different to make it, you know, be visible. So yeah, that was when it really switched for me. You know, cause the sponsors became important when you had to pay $55,000 just in entry fees. So I think that's when it really switched for me is at that point.
And you didn't know how to break dance.
Yeah,
you didn't. Or yeah, break dance or skeet in his techno dancing or, you know, whatever. Swindle in his country pole stuff. You know.
Pole dancing.
Skeet in his pole dancing.
Yeah.
Oh, that's, man.
Fabulous. That is fabulous.
Well, I think that's good, though. I mean, I think that's one of the things that's hurting our industry is all the secret keeping we do. You think about, I get it, that it helps John Murray and the other top pros who are in a position to win a big tournament and get a six-figure paycheck, but it hurts everybody else.
Yeah, and you can't do it now because there's
you can't do it.
YouTube that are going to put it out there.
Yeah, it's impossible. There is no secrets anymore.
No.
I interview guys all the time about techniques.
And at least for very long. I mean, I'll give it 20 days, you know, but then it's out.
I'm not gonna argue with you, except to say that I got guys I'll interview about techniques. I've interviewed John many times, done technique stories with John. And I don't know, maybe a third to half the time, the guy will say to me, because I'll be picking and looking for information that'll help me personally. He'll say, okay, I'm gonna give you this, but you can't make it part of the story. Mm. Guys are, and maybe it's not a bait, maybe it's a retrieve or a rigging or something like that, but guys are always still trying to keep these secrets. And your point is well taken, that when you're on camera and you have a camera on the deck with you, it's hard to keep secrets, but you still see guys covering up a bait, or that thing is only visible for a moment as he slings it out of sight. I still see a lot of guys trying to keep secrets.
Trying. That's the key. Trying.
Yeah. I mean, don't forget you have a co-angler with you too. And they see everything.
Yeah.
And so you could, you know, it's all, you know how it goes. I mean, if you got something you're doing that's a little bit trickier than what everyone else is doing, and you have your co-angler with you, that spreads like fire through a wheat field. And so, you know, it's tough. It's tough. I see what you're saying though, Ken, with the lures, because it does help everything. It helps the industry, helps keep everything funded. I mean, you're 100% correct in that. But the technique thing, I can see where you can hide some of your technique stuff easily.
Yeah, realistically, the only people that are getting exposure to the guys that are in the top 10 are the guys that are winning consistently. And when you look right now, what's going on, it's a lot of the same guys, and they're all doing the same thing with the same little stupid baits. So that, in my opinion, is not good for the industry. When you have thousands upon thousands of SKUs that need to be sold every year, millions, I don't know. And everything that's being nationally covered and televised and written about and cared about at the moment is stuff that's that big on a ball head or a little rip bait. But yeah, we'll get into that another time. Yeah.
Right.
Sorry.
That's what I did. I looked at all the stuff I have in my garage. I go, why don't I just get rid of all this and just get some scope shads and call it good?
Exactly.
You got a promo code for scope shads? You can share with us.
I despise it. I mean, I really do. Obviously, just seeing my results, but it's you got to do it.
Yeah,
you know, you got to just glue yourself to it. You know, I was raised in the time when you kept your lure in the water.
Yeah,
you don't win tournaments, your lure's not in the water. These guys never have their lure in the water until they see a fish. And they put it right on its face.
Yeah, it's become hunting.
Yeah, it's totally hunting now.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's no hope or, you know.
There's no hope.
If you're not scoping, you're hoping. That's true. Because you're just praying that you're going to get a bite.
Bass fishing in the 2020s. No, there's no
hope. We got them bed fishing in Okeechobee with live scope. I mean, come on. I thought that Okeechobee was the last haven. No. Toledo Bend and Okeechobee won. On live scope, that's the end of bass fishing as I know it.
You know, there's a bait that's out of production now that kind of brings me back to thinking this would have been a bait that might have been very popular today with live scoping. That I bet you guys are familiar with. It was the Lucky Craft Wander.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all know that bait?
Yeah.
Hard sinking bait. Yeah, it's a hard Senko. Thank you, Jeff. It's exactly what it was. Except whereas a Senko wobbles from the ends, it would kind of shimmy on the way down. It was a little hard bait, and if you twitched it, it sank. If you twitched it, it would walk underwater. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, and I've got about a dozen of them, But I always thought it was a great bait. I used to throw it around bridge pilings and just let it sink and spots and other fish when I'd go other places would nail it. I think that's a bait that might come back in today's era.
Yeah, it definitely should. And yeah, I mean, if it doesn't come back under the original manufacturer, I'm sure somebody else will have something similar. I think
the Karashi, Mega Bass Karashi in
that. Yeah, that's more, that thing's maybe two inches long, and you got to throw it. I've caught caught some fish on it earlier this year, but it's like a spinning rod bait. You'd probably throw it on, you wouldn't want to exceed like 8 pound maybe at the heaviest fluoro on that bait, and it's subsurface. It does come to the top if you work it fast enough, and it's kind of, I don't know if that would be a really viable forward facing sonar bait, but it's a really cool little bait.
Roger that.
It's about the size of the old original, like that the smallest Rapala floater they ever made. It's about as big as that thing.
It's really tiny.
Little. It's a tiny bait.
John, you mentioned it earlier with the Gitsit. Have you put a ball head on it and thrown it out there, hovering it?
No, I haven't, but it would work beautifully. Mm-hmm. Yeah, put a little tungsten head inside it and let it spiral. It'd probably be a wonderful, you know, forward-facing bait. But, yeah, I haven't, and I should. But, yeah, that'd be a great one.
BTC, yeah. You had a couple other baits you wanted to see brought back. Tell us about those.
Well, compared to you guys, this is kind of stupid, but I already mentioned the Berkeley power bait finesse worm. Really any of that original power bait. Riverside jig nobody mentioned a jig, and I guess they're kind of pretty replaceable, but the Riverside.
Mm.
Yeah. You can't really tell. It had a stand-up head.
Yeah.
It's a triangle-shaped stand-up head, and that thing would just lay down there and stand right up. Oh, no, that was our – and kind of a shorter profile, a short but broad hook on it.
Mm-hmm.
Just – it was a really nice jig.
Is that where Ike got his idea for the stone jig?
For that –
knockoff.
I did it. For his prototype,
I don't know.
I'm just kidding, Mike. Just kidding.
Well, Mike's always been one of the luckiest people I know. True story. When we were in like eighth grade, leaving a dance, walking down the railroad tracks, there was like five of us walking in a straight line down railroad tracks, heading to a pizza place, and four of us stepped in dog shit, and Mike found a $20 bill. This is true story. And so Mike always had that luck, and at the exact time, the stone jake come out Riverside. Yeah. So
okay,
still not.
That's great. I love that. The railroad track story. Oh my god!
That's so awesome. Really, he finds a freaking 20, which was a lot of money in 1985.
Yeah. Did he buy everybody pizza?
Hell no. He bought him pizza.
He bought them all Big O's.
He bought nothing.
All right, Nathan, I want to bring up one that I had on my list. And I bet everybody here knows about this bait because y'all are tackle junkies. It was a Lucky Craft spinner bait that they made in the 90s.
Oh, yeah. I remember that.
This is not the skeet bait. Yeah, there you go. This is not the skeet bait from the 2000s. This is a decade before that. And they only made it in three colors, as I recall. Y'all can correct me. They made it pink, white, and black.
Mm-hmm.
And what's up?
I said they love pink.
Well, I tell you what. If I get my hands on any of these, I get all I can. They are very hard to come by. One of these will come up on eBay maybe every 5 or 6 months. And what's special about this bait, and I'd love to get y'all's take on it, is that blade. If you look at that blade, it looks like it's on upside down. And the hole where the split ring goes through is cut at an angle. And what that makes that blade do is that blade hunts. That, because of that opening there, that blade is all out of whack and it'll suddenly just do a wild spin and cause that spinner bait as you're winding it in to kick.
Yeah.
And that bait did not do anything in the market. Well, they made it in pink, they made it in white, they made it in black. They could have done better. They could have done white and chartreuse or something like that, or straight up chartreuse. But, and obviously that was a problem. The other problem was, I think it sold for $15 in an era when you could buy a spinnerbait for $3.99. Yeah. But something, I guess probably the Pointer 78 was the reason I was willing to drop $14 or $15 on one of these. And it is still the finest spinnerbait I've ever used. It was a great drop bait. It was just great at everything. John, did you say you had some of these baits?
I've got a few, and I've had a lot of guys ask about those, you know, guys around the country, because I know Skeet and Lucky Craft and all that. But yeah, it's not something that's very, very readily available.
And is that if you, the Bevy Spin? Is that what that was called? The Bevy Spin?
Bevy?
I think it was called the MH1 was the only name I ever saw on it. And it comes in two sizes. It comes in 3/8, which is that, and 3/4, which is completely useless because the blade has a different configuration and it's just junk. I'm sorry, John, would you agree with that?
The 3/8 is the only one I've ever seen or used.
It's an amazing bait. So if anybody stumbles across one of these at a yard sale or a garage sale, I don't care what color it is, you can send them to me. But yeah, buy it, throw it. It's an amazing bait. I would not put anything much of a trailer on it. I'd use, you know, maybe just a little straight tail, if anything. But that's a fabulous bait. John, when's the last time you threw one of these things?
Oh, man, it's been a lot of years. I've used them like in Delta situations, you know, because it's more of a compact bait.
Very compact.
Does throw very well.
Another thing I like about it. Yeah. Frank, are you familiar with this one?
I've never thrown it in my life.
That surprises me because I know you're a tackle junkie like crazy, and I'm surprised you've never seen this. You need to, your hands on one.
Why not put that blade modification on any other spinnerbait and see what happens?
I can't get anybody to make that blade.
It's just oval. It's just.
It's a upside down Indiana, basically.
Yeah, I mean it's kind of cool. I like the compact profile of it.
Yeah, it's a very small, and what you can't see there, and I think John will back me up on this, is a lot of the weight is hidden underneath the skirt. So the head is pretty compact. It's just a super compact bait. The whole thing is no longer than about that with the skirt and everything. And it throws like a bullet. It doesn't need a trailer of any kind, but the blade is everything. And the reason, if I could find blades like that, I would try them on other spinner baits because I'm confident they would work. And I love a single spin, which I know makes me a dinosaur. I don't even think you're allowed to throw a single spin in some states these days. But I still think a single spin is just an incredibly versatile lure. So yeah. I want them to bring this back. Lucky Craft.
There you go.
Take note. Make that spinnerbait again, please.
Is that blade like tapered, kind of like the old Stanley Wedge blade? Is it heavier at the bottom and thinner at the top?
No.
No, it's not? Okay.
John, I don't think it is. Do you?
I don't think it is either. I think it's pretty standard all the way through.
Just the cupping, everything. It's the same.
Yeah.
Okay.
The cup. I really think the only thing that's different about it is it's an Indiana that's upside down, and that hole,
and it's slotted so that will slide in and out of that split ring, so it throws it off balance and does weird crap.
You can you don't have to. You know how guys like to snap their spinner bait and stuff like that to make it do weird things. You ain't got to do anything. You just wind it in.
That's what I was saying about that Pro Assassinator. That's what made it so unique. Is it imparted its own action to it. So. And you never knew when it was going to happen. And that's what made it insane when you get bit on it. It's like, oh, crap. That's cool.
I was talking about some of the stuff in the monologue about things that kill lures. And, of course, obviously, the only thing that really kills a lure is lack of sales. Mm-hmm. I think Lucky Craft was a self-inflicted wound here because of that $14.99 price tag. There's no way they had any more money in this product than the average Strike King or whatever spinnerbait of that era.
Right.
They were just charging 3-4 times as much and got greedy because they found out they could do it with a Pointer 78. And I hate
and
that.
Pink. Nobody's paying $14 for a pink spinnerbait.
You're right. They did not offer the kind of color options that they should have.
They didn't try.
No, you're right. They offered it in, I think, only 3 colors. John said you only got some white ones. And I think that's the best color they made. I mean, not that I don't throw a black spinnerbait, but I think I don't think many people throw a black spinnerbait except at night.
Right.
So yeah, they shot themselves in the foot with that bait.
I can see that.
Yeah.
Yeah. BTC, what you got? How are you feeling?
Terrible. Herb's Dilly, I got from a buddy. I know I came in late with that. I asked Ike if there was any baits he'd like to see brought back, and his own Devil's Spear, which was discontinued, and he did throw that a lot, and the Herb's Dilly, which is a inline. You guys familiar with it?
No.
Yeah.
I've never heard of a Herb's Dilly. No.
The inline spinnerbait or buzzbait.
Huh. Yeah. The inline buzzbait.
Hey, you know, he's probably just making shit up just to make it look stupid.
No. That's the inline buzzbait just seemed to in the 70s and 80s, stuff like the old Floyd's buzzer, the weed wing, some weed other wing. Stuff like that.
Yeah. Is that the Norman bait? The weed wing?
What? No, there was a Norman did make a bait like that.
Knock off.
But the Norman bait was the Weed Walker.
Right. I still have some of those things. They're cool.
The irony of the Weed Wing, and I know Frank and I are about the same age. John's a few years younger. The irony of the Weed Wing back in the day was it was a spoon with a tiny little buzzer in front. And the gear ratios on reels back then were like, if you had a 4-to-1, you were smoking.
You were smoking is right.
So if you threw that thing out there and you kept your rod tip high and you cranked as fast as your little fingers could work, you might be able to get that thing on the surface.
Huh.
But it was just not, you know, and that's been such a limiting factor in so many lures. You know, then it was gear ratio. There were no baits that would dive 10 feet until Lee System came along. But part of the problem was you couldn't throw a bait far enough.
I'm sure the Dacron line didn't help.
I was using catgut, Frank.
And those little 4-foot metal rods.
Yeah, the 4-foot True Temper rod. Wow. And it wasn't quite that bad. But when you go back and you look at the gear that I grew up with, well, it's pretty remarkable. But what's funny to me is, as much as the gear has changed, in something like rods, the only advancements are in the same three areas that they've always been. They are lighter, they are more sensitive, they are stronger,
and they cost more.
And they cost more. That's the chase. Everybody's chasing those three things. There's nothing else to chase. So we must have been like Hercules back then, guys, to use that equipment. We were superhuman in the 70s.
You could fence with it and fish with it. those metal runs. It's pretty awesome.
So true.
The only other thing I had on my list was a power bait color that they just discontinued. That was magic and caught everything in a Pit Boss Junior. But I don't know.
What was the color?
Camo.
Oh, I don't think we have that.
Lime purple passion.
Oh,
no, we don't have a color. We don't have a picture.
Sorry. No. Yeah.
They discontinued that.
Lime purple passion and the Pit Boss. Yeah.
Yeah, that was one. That was the color they copied off Reaction Innovations one that Kennedy used to use, and I still got some of those too. So.
Well, what's the color?
Some of those. Huh?
What's that color called in Reaction?
I can't remember, but it was definitely off that one. It was like lime with purple in it.
And Spanish fly.
Yeah, Spanish fly. That was it.
There you go.
Steve Kennedy. There's a guy who uses a lot of baits that are no longer made.
Yeah.
Yep.
He's still fishing Corrado B200.
I was going to say he's using those old reels.
And his old Kistlers from when Kistler first came out. It's pretty funny. It's awesome, though. I love that he does that.
It is very cool. Steve's a really neat guy, really smart guy.
We thought about having him on this show, but determined that he would most likely continue to hold his secrets.
There's a ton of stories I can write about the old baits Steve uses as soon as he wins a classic on them, is what he's told me.
Yeah.
Because then they won't be old anymore.
Exactly. Exactly. Well, gentlemen, it has been a blast. We've kept you longer than we intended to do. But thank you all so much for joining us.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
If you had a tenth as much fun as I did, then you had a good time. So we truly appreciate you. BTC, I know you gotta walk these guys out.
It's broke, dude.
What's that?
Can't snap.
Well, we do it one at a time, but unless you
synchronize snapping.
Okay, BTC's under a lot of strain because of the shoulder surgery. So he likes to snap his fingers and our guests just disappear. So you don't worry. Object permanency says you will still exist in your natural realm. So don't sweat that. Yeah. And truly, great thanks to all you guys. You're wonderful.
Thank you.
Here we go. Make them disappear.
Yeah.
He had eye cast.
And then there was just us.
Yeah, you should have done like snap, clap, stamped your foot, made them all pop at once.
I don't control that. I'm not in charge of those things. That's you.
You are behind the Oz curtain.
No, you're the guy behind the curtain. You're controlling everything. Like I said at the end of the monologue tonight, I said the reason you had to have reconstructive shoulder surgery, again, I'm having a hard time saying that, shoulder surgery, is because you are carrying the weight of this show on your back.
It's a team effort, buddy. And to that effect, Nathan did an amazing job tonight with getting the pictures queued up.
He always does a great job for us.
Absolutely.
Always. Yes. Well, we got some more segments coming up here. You want to introduce the next one?
Which is the top 10, right?
Yes, sir.
Tonight's top 10, which is...
Yeah, not so much what you think it is. It's going to be a little bit different.
Yeah. Go ahead, Ken.
No. You can introduce it, but we have a special top 10 planned, just for you.
Okay, I don't know where we're at. You go. I'm in pain. I can't think.
Okay, we'll try to sublimate the pain long enough to enjoy this top 10, which is dedicated to Brian the Carpenter.
What?
Here it comes.
The top 10 signs our beloved BTC is high on painkillers. Number 10. Repeatedly refers to Bass After Dark as Soul Train. Number 9, tries to pronounce NPFL as though it's a word. Number 8, his pupils are as dilated as a shark's. Number 7, he cannot spell BTC. Number 6, he regularly takes swigs from his Bass After Dark pee bottle.
Official merch coming soon.
Number 5, he's clearly more sober than normal. Number 4, wanders streets aimlessly yelling, "I'm Pete Glusick, bitches." Number 3, attempts to mute Ken using a TV remote. Number 2, changes moniker from Brian the Carpenter to Belinda the Sheetrock Girl. And the number 1 sign BTC is high on painkillers? He just bet $10,000 that Jacob Fouts will win AOI.
Oh my God, that was beautiful. Thank you.
I think that might have been the best top 10 we've ever done.
I'm honored. My God. Undeserving.
That's been in the works for a couple of weeks now. And I just love those.
Really? It just seemed like you just whipped that up last second.
Well, no. We went through the motions with you to try to create a top 10 for this week, knowing we were not going to use it.
That's beautiful. Good, because I didn't even contribute as far as I remember.
Well, no, you didn't contribute to that because, of course, that was in your honor. So, we're so excited that you're able to do the show tonight. We worried about you. And you know, in your honor, we had to have a very special top 10.
Thanks, man. That was freaking awesome. I didn't expect it. And I'm laughing hysterically inside right now.
Well, tomorrow, hopefully, when you feel a little better, maybe you'll go back and revisit it because... I there were some gems in there. There were some
the ones that didn't make it.
Oh, the ones that didn't make it were awfully good too. We'll talk about those another time. But we're not done. We got more stuff. We got more new stuff.
Yeah. We're bringing that in tonight, right?
Yeah.
Dark
thoughts is how we close out the show with you, if you're up to it.
I believe I have a dark thought for this evening.
You do?
Yes.
Excellent. Well,
probably gonna be terrible,
but the thing that I was going to talk about next was involves our intern.
Yeah.
Jacob Morrison. Jacob's been doing some great work for us, helping us out a lot with social media. He helps us out on the top 10. He's been a gem and a lot of fun, a smart, talented young guy. And he has been, among his other responsibilities, he has been monitoring some of the social media posts and the chat on YouTube while the show's been going on. And the section that we're now going to call bad comments.
That's what the hell is that? Yeah.
No, bad comments, bad BAD Bass After Dark. Jacob is gonna go through some of those with us. So let's welcome Jacob Morrison.
We have an intro for it.
What an intro.
You got Michael Jackson as your opening act, Jacob. How about that?
How about it?
Wow, that's amazing.
Got to tell a quick story on Jacob at Jacob's expense before we get started here, BTC. When he first reached out to us, you know, we had mentioned in a show or two that we were looking for somebody to come in and help us and so forth. And Jacob responded and he sent me a note because my email is pretty much out there for anybody who wants to send it to me. And he said that he really enjoyed Bass Talk Live. And I said, well, we're not exactly Bass Talk Live.
That's fantastic.
But he realized he had made the mistake after he had clicked send. So I like to give, so the first time we talked to Jacob in a video call, I made sure I was wearing my BTL cap for that.
Yes, and yes, we did. And so we're looking for a nickname, guys. We haven't really come up with a solid name for Jake yet. And, you know, I'm a firm believer that, you know, the name's got to present itself. You don't try too hard. It just happens. It happens. It's magic. Something leads up to it. And that's how I feel, you know. Or the message board, some savagery from the message board. Yeah.
Jacob, how has your time with Bass After Dark been so far?
It's been terrible. I every week just drags, you know. It's not very much fun.
Man, we did not expect you to be candid, Jacob. You're supposed to... Yeah. Not really what we were looking for.
Well, why did you cry?
I hope that's not true. You cry yourself to sleep, I'm sure.
Of course, I'm kidding. It's been great.
We're a lot to put up with, and I regret that. I do. But hopefully you're having a good time, because we're certainly enjoying working with you on this stuff.
Definitely enjoying it.
Yes.
Now, did you have a chance to see that lead-in that Nathan created for you before it was live?
Yeah, I did. I'm pretty sure he put me in live as I was laughing at it.
That's amazing, dude.
I knew there was...
That was a surprise to me, so...
I knew he had something, but I didn't know what it was, and so that's why I didn't do a better job of leading in there. It was cool.
That was very cool.
Well, tell us about bad comments.
All right, so bad comments is basically going to be our own knockoff of the mean tweets. So we're going to be reading your guys's mean tweets that come up throughout the show and giving you a little shout out. So in the future, as long as it's not too egregious, if you leave a bad comment, you might get featured in bad comments,
which means no real hardcore profanity and nothing that's negative about me, because I'm very sensitive. No, take your shots at me. Go ahead.
We could always do like Stern did when he was on the radio and just, you know, make up a word for that foul word. And, you know what I mean?
Jacob, that might be another responsibility for you, is to come up with words to replace the really bad ones.
Should and replace again. Them with fishing terms.
Oh, you're on to something. I like that. That's excellent. I mean, flipping is already used for the F word. So yeah, that's a good fit. I like it. Well, do we have some good ones tonight?
I think so. Hopefully they're better in the weeks to come, but we'll start off with Curve. I'm not really sure how to say that one, but right at 9 o'clock, 8 o'clock comes at the same time every day, guys.
Well, Curve, it does. And I thought we started right on time. But you know, we like to think we're worth it. We're worth the wait.
Next we have Drunkwood.
Oh boy, this guy.
Ken's drink would have me in bed by 9:20.
Drunkwood, I gotta confess, this is tea. My wife makes me tea.
Or so
sometimes it's bourbon, but this is tea.
Ken, never tell him the truth. What kind of fisherman are you?
That's a good point.
Keep him rolling.
I'm way too transparent.
Next we have Epic Eric. Let's Epic hear it, Ken. I think that was a typo. He was trying to say Ken, but
Epic Eric, I told you not to call me Jen in public. How dare you?
Next we have Paul Irizarry. Paul Irizarry doesn't have his booze shelf and penis bait on display tonight.
I really appreciate Paul noticing that, and not so much that, you know, the background's different, but he noticed the dick bait, and I thank you for that, Paul.
Next we got Mike Soul. BTC is perked up and gots the mumbles, LOL.
Yeah. I wish not.
We were expecting that, Mike. We were really expecting BTC to be kind of out of it tonight.
Yeah.
And that's why we made the top 10, to be, you know, top 10 signs that BTC is high on painkillers.
But I thought it would be two, because when I had the surgery in 22, they did a bunch of shit. It was a different deal. They didn't do a nerve block, so I was on, but no friggin' painkillers tonight. So, sorry, I don't like them things.
You look like you're in some pain.
I'm uncomfortable.
Yeah.
All right.
Sorry, Jacob. What you got?
Next, we got Kevin Ledford. Their narcotics run out. BTC will be hurting.
Yes. Yes, indeed. But been hurting for years, so it's all good. Carry on.
All right. And lastly, I'm throwing a curveball at Nathan. Sorry. But we're going to go with Kyle Mollett. He said that he hopes BTC learns to wipe left-handed.
Been doing it for about 8 months now. So, anyhow,
I had not thought about that need, and I wish that had not been brought to my attention, quite frankly.
Yeah. It's a thing, Ken.
Yeah, I can imagine. Jacob, that was awesome.
I'm not going to have as much problem with that, but trying to text with my left. Jacob looks like you voted for Biden twice.
I just saw that, too.
That's right. Jacob is fair game, too. It's not just me, BTC, and Nathan. Jacob is also fair game.
That's right. We want you guys to come after him.
Oh, well, yeah. Once my buddies find this, it'll be all over for me.
So no dickheaded comments tonight? Nothing?
Nothing too bad.
We didn't have a troll?
No.
Did we block that one?
Yeah.
And keep in mind, folks, if you fired us, we may fire back.
Yeah. You know, I mean, if we deserve it, you know.
Yeah, we can take it. We're big boys.
Right. Corrective criticism. But just being a twat, can't help myself.
And we do want constructive criticism. You know, we want to make this show the best it can be.
True. Just work on your approach. You know what I mean?
We're ripping and tearing here. That's all we're doing. We're ripping and tearing. Jacob Morrison.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. That was awesome.
Yeah.
We'll take it back. That is thanks to the incredibly talented and lovely Nathan Benson, who is kills it every week on Bass After Dark, but doesn't so much like to be in front of the camera.
He's out of control.
He is out of control. He is out of control. Well, you know what? That about does it for me, you know?
Oh, did we have any plugs? Help me out here. We went through everything. Guys,
you know, we want to thank everybody for joining us. We want to, we want people to like and share and subscribe and all that. And the share part is a huge deal to me, because if all y'all would share this with one person and get them to subscribe, we could really grow this thing fast. And that helps us get guests, you know. I've been really pleased with how many people I'll call to ask them to be a guest, and they know about the show.
Yeah.
But it's not everybody, and we want everybody to know about the show. So yeah. Anything you can do to help us spread the word, that's a big deal.
We also like to see our efforts, see some return on our efforts.
Yeah, that's why we're looking. Coca-Cola, Toyota, General Motors, Merck, all the major pharmaceutical companies, we're talking to you. No, if we can find sponsorship, that'd be lovely.
Indeed. Yeah, put a lot of effort into it and time and such. And I enjoy the hell out of it. I do enjoy the crowds that come and watch the show. And that's, you know, none of that pays bills, but
yeah, is
what I know that getting into it. And it's just fishing anyhow. So
yeah, we're having a good time. We hope we think we're delivering a good product, and we hope you enjoy it. And as I like to say, we also enjoy eating and living indoors. So sponsorship would be great. I want to thank our guests, John Murray, Frank Scalish, Jeff Hodges. They were all terrific. I thought it was a really strong conversation tonight. I want to thank our partner and engineer, Nathan Benson. He's the voice of our top 10. Jacob, our intern, did a fabulous job with Bad Comments. James Riley gave us the finest logo in YouTube channels or podcasting or anything else. I love our logo. And Ron Stallings did such a smooth, fabulous job with our introduction at the top of the show. We don't know what our next topic's going to be.
No, still not.
Yeah, that's... Y'all need to be privy to that. That's a show in itself, is me and BTC. And hey,
yeah, and guys, we're open to suggestions. What would you like to see? You know, what topics? Fire away. Hit us up. Hit us in the DMs. Hit us on social media. Email Ken. Don't email me ever.
Ken@mycropterist.com. If you're a bass fisherman, you know what mycropterist means. You know how to spell it. Our next show is a week from tonight. February 15th. Hope you'll join us for that one, no matter what the topic is. And now it's time for me to say au revoir. It's so hard to say au revoir. Let's just say hors d'oeuvre. And BTC, if you will snap me out, I'll get out of your way so you can share some dark thoughts with us.
Snap. All right. There's a fine line between genius and idiot. And I try to lay it out there what I mean by that. It's something I come up with, and I'm sure it's a guys kind of get it, but take things right to the edge and still have success. It's like genius. You know what I mean? Order material for a job and you order just the right amount, zero waste. Fucking nail it. Versus you're half a board short and you got to run this. So that's kind of where that concept in my mind, and I see it relate to a lot of things. You know, I'm a big proponent of a man being a man and working through some stuff and not, you know, every little boo-boo laying on the couch, popping Percocets and being a pile of shit. However, you know, sometimes you do got to go to the hospital or doctor or get some stuff done. This has been lingering since 2015, and I should have dealt with it then. Now it's a lot worse. Titanium ball on the shoulder and ground mite, shoulder socket, whatever, shoulder replacement, a modification of a shoulder replacement is what I had done today. But the last few years have been really tough working through that. My fishing sucked. Can't fully extend my arm on a flip. So my pitching, you know, keep the elbow tucked and try to. So anyhow, my fishing's kind of sucked. It's whatever. But yeah, be a man, just not too much of a man. You know what I mean? Go to the doctor. Be smart about it. That's all I got. Don't be an idiot. Thank you, guys. I really appreciate everybody that watched tonight. And yes, spread the word. See you guys next week. Ha ha.